Well, good afternoon. Well, we appreciate you coming this afternoon. We've got a wonderful lineup. I have one introduction to make, and Mark and actually two introductions. Mark and Dr. John Karelja will be introducing all of our panelists. Of course, we have a particularly interesting topic to talk about. I have spent the majority of my career working in school districts that had levies to move budgets along and to take care of different things. That has not been what I've experienced here in Pennsylvania, but I know that's for sure something that people are talking about. And so I've had a little bit of experience dealing with some of the things that might become issues for us that we'll talk about. And I can tell you from the standpoint of being a superintendent, it does change the way you live. It does change what you're doing on the job. Some people might say it changes for the better. Others would say, no, not quite so much. But it does change, and so there's no doubt whatsoever. We hope that today will be a learning experience for all of us, that you folks here will have great questions for our panelists, that they can respond to different things that you have concerns with or different ideas that you might have, and that all of us can leave today with a little bit more knowledge about the topic. So with that, a very good friend of mine is returning to the greater Susquehanna Valley, Dr. Mark DiRocco. Mark left us in December and has been working in Harrisburg at a very busy time. He'll be up and speak in just a moment, and then right after him, Dr. John Karelja will be emceeing the rest of the program. So, Dr. Mark.
Today we're here to talk about the need for fair and equitable funding across Pennsylvania, and also some things that are happening in the legislature. And I am very pleased to be here today to share some information with you, an overall perspective from what's going on from my view down in Harrisburg. Tomorrow the governor's going to announce his budget. That's about midday, around 11:30, so we'll see what will be happening as far as proposals for subsidy, both basic subsidy and special education subsidy, and we'll see what the governor has in store, and then we'll see what the legislature's reaction is to that. But what we do know is this, that since 2007, there have been two marquee studies that have been done that show that public education is somewhere between $3 to $4 billion short, and that's billion with a B, as far as funding for students across the Commonwealth. These studies were done by reputable firms, and so if we take a look at what would that entail as far as being able to catch up, there's been talk over the years, even if we put about $400 million in new subsidy dollars in the budget every single year, it would take 7 to 8 years for the Commonwealth to catch up to adequately educate our children as they need to be educated. So we do know this, that the current budget situation is very gloomy. Revenues are well behind what were anticipated. There's a structural deficit at the state anywhere between $1.7 billion and $3 billion, depending who you're talking to. And as they said, revenues for the current year are falling about $600 million short right now. So we know that an increase of about $400 million for basic subsidy and special ed subsidy probably is not going to happen. We're realistic about that. But here's the sad news, is it will take just $100 million in new subsidy dollars just to cover the PSERS increases that districts have to pay. So anything below $100 million means that districts will actually be cut in subsidy. They'll be actually cut in what they can spend on children. And we're not really sure if we're going to receive much more than $100 million in the governor's budget proposal. We're hoping for the best, but we're pretty sure we're not going to receive a proposal in the area of $400 million that would be needed. Now, recently, our two organizations, the Pennsylvania Association of School Administrators and the Pennsylvania Association of Business Officials, completed our annual budget survey. 361 districts across the state responded to that survey, and I have some copies that I gave to Jen that she can distribute to any members of the media or anyone that wants them afterwards. And here's what we found from this recent year. Believe it or not, 6 years since the Great Recession and 6 years since that first tremendous cutback in public education back in 2011, we still had 33% of the districts this year who responded to the survey, they made cuts in their staff. 37% of districts increased class size, and most of the districts that did that increased class sizes at the elementary level, where research tells us that small class size is the most meaningful to education of children. And 37% of the districts that responded actually reduced their academic offerings. So if there is some sense or notion out there that things are getting better in school districts, that is simply not the case. And in that study, there are actually 6 anecdotal stories from districts all across the state, from all different types of makeup and geographical areas, telling their stories, and it's pretty depressing, actually. However, there was a silver lining in that study, and the silver lining is this: money does matter. What the study showed is that about 50% of the districts said that they were actually going to make reductions when they were putting their budgets together last spring, and 13% of those districts were able to hold that off based on the subsidy increases that did come in. So when the money does come in and it is being applied to the educational process and programs for kids, then the cuts did not occur. And actually 26% of the districts that said they were going to reduce programs were able to hold on to them and maintain them. Unfortunately, about 70% of the districts that responded to that survey said that they plan to increase property taxes in this coming year. And then that leads us to Senate Bill 76 that has been very much in the news recently. There is a great deal of talk about property tax elimination bill, and the last bill that was floated was known as Senate Bill 76. I want to just make a couple comments on this before I turn it over to Dr. Karelja. I want everyone to understand that this is not property tax elimination. This is a huge tax shift in the way we fund schools. So the taxes are going to shift from property taxes to personal income taxes and sales or use taxes. And much of that burden that is now on property taxes is going to be shifted to individuals, especially working families. And they are going to receive the lion's share of the hit on this and the transfer of that entire burden. Please understand also that all property taxes will not be eliminated. Any school district that has debt service right now, an existing debt service, they will be able to continue to collect property taxes to pay that debt service for the length of the bonds that they have out. So it's a misnomer to think that everyone's property taxes are just going to magically go away. The other thing that is sad here in this slide shows a good picture of this, is that about two-thirds of the districts in Pennsylvania will actually pay more money in taxes to Harrisburg than will come back to the local school districts. So for the most part, two-thirds of Pennsylvania is going to be subsidizing the southeastern part of the state, the greater Philadelphia area. Because what this proposed legislation does is it says that we're going to hold you harmless. Whatever you've collected in property tax right now, we're going to guarantee you that much back in sales tax and personal income tax. Well, in order to do that, the state has to make up $14 billion in taxes, $14 billion with a B. And they're going to be pulling money from all parts of the state to make sure that everyone received what they did last year in property taxes. So here's the stark difference with that. Some districts across the state, especially in small rural areas, collect as little as $3,000 per student in property taxes. Other districts, such as in the southeastern part of the state, collect as much as $28,000 per student in property taxes. So those people in the southeastern part of the state are guaranteed their $28,000 per kid. And the only guarantee that those small rural districts have in other parts of the state is their $3,000 per kid. There is nothing fair or equitable about that. Also, there's the loss of local control. Remember, all this money will now go to Harrisburg, and Harrisburg will determine how it's allocated. We do not think that is good for public education. We do not think that is good for local communities. We think the people who are elected as school board members, better understand the needs of their communities and their districts and their children, and we believe that control should stay with them. So people often ask me, well, what's the alternative? We know that property taxes are a real issue. We don't deny that. There are several alternatives to reduce property taxes in Pennsylvania. There have been several other bills floated to give senior citizens more of a break, to increase the homestead-farmstead exclusion. So we can make shifts in the property taxes and go into other types of funding situations, but they don't have to be as extreme as Senate Bill 76. But now I want to bring up Dr. Karelja, and there's a wonderful panel or group of panelists here that can explain what's going on in their local school districts and their local communities that will bring this picture home for you even more. So, Dr. Karelja.
Thank you, Dr. Duraco. I came to the IU about 6 months ago, and I was a superintendent at Warrior Run. And Dr. Duraco and I had the opportunity to present down in Harrisburg when they were talking about the funding formula. And one of the other factors that came out was critical was predictability. So if you're a small district and you need to know what you can expect for the year to come because all the staffing considerations we have, that's another factor that has to be considered as they bring up this dramatic change with Senate Bill 76. The next thing I get to do is introduce friends and colleagues who have valuable insight to share with you about the impacts of these proposed changes on education. They represent the best thinkers that I know in our area regarding these topics. They're superintendents, business managers, representatives from business community, teachers, board members, that we're anxious to hear what they have to say. So with that, I'm gonna move right along and introduce my friend Chad Coors, who's the superintendent at Selins Grove Area School District.
Thank you, John, appreciate the kind words. Make a few comments about the proposed property tax reform, starting with the fact that no one likes to pay taxes, but that's how we fund schools, governments, and agencies around the state. The local property taxes that we all pay benefit our local communities. Changing the way that our local property taxes are collected means that our local monies will go directly to Harrisburg, and those monies will get redistributed around the state. This means that there will be winners and losers as taxes shift to increasing personal income tax and increased sales tax. The reduction or elimination of property taxes, however, does not eliminate the local and county property taxes. I did a quick calculation in our Selins Grove Area School District. Residents would still pay their borough property tax, which amounts to about $408. They would still pay their county property tax, which amounts to $523. And including the most recent proposal that the debt service would stay on as a school tax, a local resident in Selins Grove would still pay $252 in school taxes, which that amounts to a reduction to a property owner in Selins Grove of about $1,300 in their property taxes, which means they're still going to pay almost $1,200 in property taxes and increased sales and income tax. So what this does is it means the state becomes responsible not only for our basic education funding, but actually an additional a total of 74% of our district funds would rely on Harrisburg. And for some of my neighboring school districts, it would actually mean that 90% of all of their funding would be coming from Harrisburg. For us as a school system, property taxes are a very reliable, steady funding source, and they're also established by our local elected school boards. And those local elected school boards know the needs of our communities and what's in the best interest of our students, much more so than folks down in Harrisburg probably do. So it really does take away that local control. And as local control gets taken away, that means at the local levels, we're forced to make reductions in programs and services for our students. which to me is probably the biggest factor in this whole property tax reform that really causes me great concern. As most of you know, school districts are actually currently underway, well underway, in establishing their 2017-2018 district budgets because we are compelled by law to have our district's budgets in place by the end of June. Actually, I believe that's also on the books for Harrisburg, but if you follow local budget news, that hasn't happened recently in the past few years. So as districts are required to develop their budgets, we are in limbo waiting for Harrisburg to figure out how they're going to allocate basic education dollars to our local communities. So again, as a school system and the students and parents in our communities need to, basically we need to put them on hold and say, well, when the state determines the funding, then we can again hopefully begin to operate programs and services. So while shifting the reliance of away from property tax may be perceived as a good thing, implementing it properly and haphazardly really creates some negative impacts for our students. And in my business, I firmly believe that public education needs to be our priority number one, and that starts with a fair, reliable funding source for our students. So, thank you.
Just wanted to restate that we will be taking questions after all the perspectives have been heard from. The next person we have to hear from is Bob Garrett, who represents the Greater Susquehanna Valley Chamber of Commerce as their president and CEO.
Thank you for having me here today. It's great to have a seat at the table with the education leaders of the Valley because business and education are attached at the hip, if you will. The employees that businesses need to do the jobs to keep the economic recovery that's just starting going are coming from our local public schools and public institutions, and that connection is critical. In fact, I would use a ag business sort of a, I don't think it's cliche, but a saying is that not investing in education is the equivalent of eating your seed corn. And we all know if you eat your seed corn, there won't be any corn in the next season. If you don't invest in education, there's not going to be any workers to keep this economic recovery going. And I think you all know that we have a lot going on in the economy here in the Valley. Well, the members of the press and maybe some others have received the legislative agenda from the Greater Susquehanna Valley Chamber of Commerce. And interestingly enough, even though this is dated 2016, it will affect 2017, because I can tell you it's not going to change much. Let me tell you how this week is going to go at the chamber. Today, we put out our e-alert, which was basically a heads up. Tomorrow morning, there's going to be a new state budget. We're going to be down in Harrisburg tomorrow, there for the budget. The PA chamber will be up in the gallery. I'll be out in the peanut gallery, out in the hallways, listening for the budget. Then first thing Wednesday morning, we have a breakfast meeting with Randy Albright, the budget secretary, to talk about the budget and what's in there and how business can be involved and how we can support the things that are good and not support the things that are bad, encouraging the legislature and the governor to work together and come up with an on-time, fiscally constrained, responsible state budget. And that'll be, that's at 8 a.m. Then at 10 a.m. we'll be with Jake Corman, the leader of the Senate. Also talking to him, Jake is from just to our west, very interested in what's going on. Then Thursday, we'll probably all be back in our offices, scratching our heads and figuring out what does this mean, in my case, for the greater Susquehanna Valley, which we define as Union-Snyder and Northumberland-Montour County. And then Friday morning, we switch our focus slightly, and we'll be having breakfast that morning over to Country Cupboard. You're all invited with Congressman Lou Barletta, and getting a report from the federal government, and hopefully he'll be talking about his initiatives there. But specifically, I guess what we are taking giving the hairy eyeball to is this proposal to be changing and shifting tax from one side to another. I think you all are very familiar with how taxes are collected, particularly those taxes or the funding that supports education, and business is very comfortable with that, and it's a model they can live with. We would be very skeptical of any wholesale change of that. We're also going to be The one other thing we're not going to do is let a good crisis go to waste, and $2 billion or $3 billion, whichever report you believe, hole in the budget is absolutely a crisis, and we're going to try to be bringing everybody's attention. Rather than smoke and mirrors of shifting tax burden, let's focus on the pension issue, which is, from business's viewpoint, the number one issue with our state budget. So coming around to you is our legislative agenda. It will be updated later this week, and it'll read 2017 legislative agenda, but you'll see both an item about responsible state spending and budgeting, as well as an item on quality educational opportunities. And we're glad to be at the table, and thank you for having us, and please know that business and education are working together hand in glove on this one.
Thank you, Bob. The next person we have to lend their experience to this conversation is a superintendent who has vast experience in multiple districts in this area. And with that, I would introduce Cheryl Latour from Danville.
Thank you. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to speak this evening regarding the struggles of public education today and the property tax proposal. Shortly, my business manager, Janice Vanna, will be speaking to the financial constraints that we are dealing with. But my goal this evening is to provide you with the perspective of public schools and what we are dealing with. The Heartland region alone is doing some really great things. Five of our schools have been awarded a National Blue Ribbon. We continue to expand program components, such as our STEM initiatives, work in literacy, such as the Orton-Gillingham program, AP courses, and also the partnerships with our local universities, including our ACE courses and the STEM courses that we now offer through Bloomsburg University. Our intermediate unit alone assists us with so many resources, from programming to professional development to filling the void with substitute teachers. All schools in this region have displayed growth and exemplify professionalism and a quality education for all students. Yet we are struggling in so many ways. For example, our special education population, at Danville alone, it is 20%. In most schools, it is about 30%. One special needs student can average $60,000 to $100,000 if sent out of district. Many of us are struggling with the need for alternative education, and this continues to grow. At times, we have to send our students out. That can be from anywhere from $80 to $150 a day. Many students leave us for whatever reason and go to cyber or charter schools. The cost of these placements can range anywhere from $8,000 to $20,000 per student. Many of these students return back to the home school. They're credit deficient and they need to be retained in a grade. Again, another cost to our taxpayers. So we are looking for options. At Danville, we started our own alternative education program and our own cyber school. Last year, we had 100% graduation. 4 years ago, cyber schools alone cost Danville Area School District over $500,000. These were students who were leaving our district. Many of our students today deal with mental health issues, drug and alcohol issues, homelessness, foster care, and students who need surrogate parenting. We have become the surrogate parents for many of these students. As many of you are aware, we receive an unfunded mandate probably every other month in public education, from the new foster care requirements to transportation of these students to training, such as the mandated child abuse, suicide prevention, numerous medical trainees, concussion training, EpiPen training, and we are mandated to implement these things. Most are unfunded mandates. Federal dollars continue to decline. Head Start is a critical early childhood program, and yet this funding is being decreased. Title I funding, designed to meet those needs of economically disadvantaged children and children who are struggling in reading and math, continue to decline. Many of our schools are cutting programs, and in my opinion, the most important programs, the arts. We've had to cut the arts, we've had to cut staffing, and now sports are also being cut. Class size continues to grow, especially at the elementary level. Many of our buildings are in need of updates and repairs, and with this, we are not able to provide adequate school facilities. So when someone asks me what is the most important resource the state of Pennsylvania has, I always respond, our children. The schools many times are the only chance a child has. We need to invest in each and every child to ensure they have a skill set and make them successful upon graduation. We are in dire need of support. It takes a village to raise a child, and tonight we are here to appeal for adequate funding to service each and every child. Thank you.
Thank you, Cheryl. Next, another valuable perspective. We have Kathy Swope, who represents the Lewisburg Area School District as president and the PA Board Association of Intermediate Past Presidents. So she has a lot of experience that she can lend to this discussion. So Kathy, thank you for coming.
Thank you, and good evening, everyone. I will start by saying that I've had the opportunity, particularly over the last year as PSBA president, to visit many districts across the state, and particularly in the last few months, I am hearing a growing concern, particularly about this upcoming budget. And I would like to share a little bit about why school districts that I've spoken to across the state are so concerned as they begin to prepare their 17-18 budgets. First, we're being told by legislators that this is going to be an extremely difficult budget for the state. And many districts are already in dire straits. They have cut many, as you've heard from the others, I'm going to try not to duplicate the statement, but it's so true. There are districts who have cut music, arts, home economics. They have cut programs that, library programs, in order to try to make ends meet. In our own district over the past few years, many of the districts in our IU have tried so hard to insulate the students from the impact of this financial crisis that schools have been experiencing. We've tried to do things that have not directly impacted students in any way we possibly can. One initiative is one that Lewisburg and Selins Grove have done, and that is we share a food service director. Instead of each of us paying a food service director, we share one, and actually Sun ATC shares the same food service director. So Mr. Oswald is stretched very thin in trying to do all those jobs. In addition, we have people in each of the districts that are trying to take on additional work that they can't do because they're trying to do so much in so many different districts and places. So we have so many essential things that we need to be giving our children that are being eliminated across the state. So when children aren't receiving these essential components of a well-rounded education, well, to me, I don't know what you all think, but that's a sign we've gone too far. And it's time to stop asking schools to take additional cuts, take a step back, and as Mark mentioned in his comments, what more do we need in order to give our students a quality education? This is tomorrow we're talking about. This is our future. And investing in education is the most important way we create a tomorrow for our community. In the 1970s, I don't know how many people know this, but about 50% of the basic instructional expenses were funded by the state. Today, that number is about 36%. So it's dramatically reduced. And Jennifer, would you bring up my slide on the PEESRs? We've been talking a little bit about the PEESRs, and I just wanted to show you in Lewisburg the impact that that's having. Basically, I tried to keep it really simple, and I took the year 2012-13, that school year. That was the PEESRs cost. The state contributes about half of what we pay back to us, so there's a net amount that is the cost to the school district, which you see was just under $800,000. The PEESRs rate at that time was 12.36%. Now, the next number I give you is 2016-17, just last year. That's not a long time. That's a five-year change, if that. And the numbers that you see there, you can see that the cost of PEESRs has jumped to nearly $4 million for this school district alone. And you can see the net difference. The PEESRs rate is 30.03%, okay? That is an enormous jump of, in that short time, of 17.67%. that cannot be sustained. It's been occurring on a regular basis each year, a dramatic jump. The other thing is that for next year, for the 17-18 budget, it's going to increase to 32.57%. It doesn't stop. For the year 21-22, it is being projected that that school year, we will be paying 36.40% in PSERS payments alone. So what I want you to understand is, when everybody keeps looking and saying, you know, we just keep putting more money into education, this is where the bulk of every district money, district school district's money is going, is keeping up with the PSERS increase. Now, this is something that must be fixed by the legislature. We can't control this at the local level. It must be done. And repeatedly, what's been happening is that they keep admiring the problem, they keep studying the issue, but they've made one small change, but it wasn't enough to really fix the problem long term. And we've got to give them the, I guess, the permission to understand that some people are not going to be happy with the outcome. It needs to be done for the security of the future. So I would ask that you encourage your legislators to please take action on taking care of the PSERS issue. I wanted to show you a little bit about the other big hit that's been happening to our local school districts. And this is just Lewisburg. This is not different for any other district, as I'm sure you'll hear. But I want to talk about special education funding for just a moment. In 2013-14, that's the revenue that we received, a little over $1 million. Our expenses were $2.7 million. This is just Lewisburg. In 2015-16, we had an increase, cumulative, a little bit in some of those years, none in others. But now, as we look at that year, that time that has passed, in three short years, our revenue has increased to by $34,000. But look at the difference in our expenses, over $600,000 deficit between what we've received and what we have had to put out. That money has to come from somewhere. So that's the other big impact, because those children, the special education children, we are required by federal law to provide whatever they need to give them a free and appropriate education. And it's the right thing to do, which is why we do it, but we're required to do it, and we're not getting any help. We're not getting help from the federal government. We're not getting the help from the state government that we need. It has remained basically unchanged, the funding for special ed. So the next part that I'm going to move on to then is, let's talk a little bit about House Bill 76. I want to just put my two cents on this issue. This is for Lewisburg, how much the assessed value. We don't get that middle figure, of course, but that's the property tax that is paid on those numbers. So the commercial tax, the commercial property, is $4.2 million that we receive for commercial. And the $12.7 million is what we receive in residential property taxes. This is just the property taxes. Our annual budget is a little over $33 million, okay? But what you're seeing, okay, is that, and what I'm concerned about, and I don't think everybody's thinking about this, if we eliminate property taxes, the number one taxpayer in Lewisburg, and I'm not picking on them, is Walmart. So what's happening is Walmart's not going to pay anything, and that is going to have to be made up. Their portion and the other commercial properties, this is, you know, doctor's offices and all kinds of businesses in our community, they will not contribute anything toward the education of children. And what will happen is that portion will need to be made up, plus the portion that is being taken from residential will need to be made up, and the burden will shift to families from the businesses. And that's what I wanted to just touch on. So it'll shift to, as Mark mentioned, higher sales tax and higher earned income tax. Commercial properties don't pay earned income tax. Families do. So we need to look at how this will impact. Everybody loves the sound of not paying property taxes. Believe me, my husband will be the first one to tell you. He often will chide me about taxes went up again. I'm like, look at the reasons why. So we don't want to do that. As school directors, we're not looking to raise people's taxes. We're trying to be as frugal as we can with every dollar that we get. But we're coming up to the end, folks. There's not much left to go when we have no place to turn for additional monies, because school districts will lose the power to be able to make up that difference. So what will happen in the future is that if we don't get the money from the state, if this were enacted, and we don't get the money from the state that we need to maintain our programs, and as that PCRS bill goes up and as special ed goes up, where do we have to go to find the money to pay those bills? There's only one place. We cut programs. And I think that's since education is our investment in tomorrow, I think that's why many of us on school boards across the state are very concerned about where we're going with this budget and this legislation. Thank you.
Thank you, Kathy. Two things that were mentioned, because we talk about property tax elimination, and it did strike me not long ago that it's not elimination of property taxes. There's elimination of school property taxes to a small amount, but the general public does need to remember that it's not eliminating all school property taxes, just a reduction in the school portion of that. The other thing that has come up as being a superintendent is when the funds come into school districts. As the funds come in, the property taxes are the numbers that come in first. That's what pays the bills until the state budget is established. And without those property taxes coming in and a state budget that's not established or finalized right away, there's no funds coming in to keep the ball rolling to pay the bills. So that's another factor that often gets missed. So another person and a valuable perspective for our area is Joanne Troutman from the Greater Susquehanna Valley United Way, and she serves there as president and CEO.
Thanks, John. Thanks for having me here. I am too pleased to be at the table here with all of you. As the CEO of the local United Way, I could stand here all night and tell you statistics about our local community, but I find it is more effective to tell stories, not through statistics, but through painting a mental picture. Imagine you're a single mother, children ages 12, 8, and 5. You work two jobs for a total of 70 hours a week, relying on whatever babysitting you can find. Child support and public support is sparse, but you're doing your very best to create a good life for your children. In a world where child care is unreliable, your kids end up spending a lot of time alone, unsupervised. Your middle son's teachers are the first to notice when he starts acting out and offer a plan to set him on the right path. Now imagine you're an 18-year-old senior in high school. You're a boy living independently with your younger siblings who you are now raising. You work full-time, nearly, to keep the bills paid and food on the table for all of you. You know you need to graduate to give yourself the best chance of success in life, but right now surviving is your priority. You become truant to the point of nearly dropping out until a guidance counselor reaches out and offers help for your entire family. And now you're a 14-year-old girl in foster care. You've been in and out of the system nearly your entire life. Despite that, you're a good student academically. But some days, emotionally, just feel impossible to get through. Someone offers you a pill at a party. You take it, and just like that, all of the pain goes away. It's not long before you take another and another. And when you have to pay for the pills, you start heroin because it's cheaper. Your foster parents don't know how to help you. So your school's student assistance program team steps in before it's too late. Now imagine you're that SAP member whose class sizes will be 50% larger next year, so you don't know if you'll have much time to have conversations with students. Or the guidance counselor who spends far more time navigating the social services system than helping kids make career and college choices. Or finally, the business manager who has no idea what the future holds and is faced with cutting personnel and already stretched resources due to financial constraints. These are stories based on real events in our community right now. Everyday lives hang in the balance. Families in which week to week and paycheck to paycheck are not even the right phrases. Families live day to day, hour by hour, minute to minute. These are stories about children we are expecting our schools to educate when education is clearly not their first priority. These are stories about educators and our school system going above and beyond to save our kids who need saving. Too many children in our valley face instability in their lives. Often the 7 or 8 hours they spend in school each day is the closest thing they will ever get. Even in a school system where the budget has already been tightened and there are fewer supports and more emphasis on regulated, mandated testing, schools have done everything possible to remain the first line of defense for kids like these. Can you envision a community without that? Not a week goes by in my work when I am not in touch with a school teacher, a guidance counselor, a secretary, a school administrator who is trying to find help for children and families like these. I just had a conversation earlier with Chad about a family I'm working with. Their jobs are to educate, even when education becomes impossible. We're not Philadelphia or Pittsburgh or Harrisburg. Poverty and struggle mean something very different here. It takes on a different face, yes, but that face is often not well recognized for what it is by our government, and therefore resources are often scarce. So as a community, we do whatever we can to rally and maximize the resources we do have. We get creative. We become as efficient as possible. We do more with less, as you heard Kathy say. We have begun to increasingly create public-private partnerships, becoming more reliant on private philanthropic dollars and nonprofits to fill the void when our public schools and agencies can't always fill them due to already limited resources. There is a tremendous pressure on schools to create long-term change in children's lives, but we give our school system very few useful tools to do so. Politics in a broken system create an environment of constant flux, ever-evolving mandates, and unreasonable barriers. Without question, changes need to be made, but the changes that need to be made should create more opportunity, not less. It should create more stability, not less, and there should be a better contingency plan. It's already nearly impossible for schools to plan beyond year to year. Introducing more and major financial instability into our public education decision, or public education, is the wrong decision. Say what you will about the choices we make in life as adults, but no child asks to be born into poverty, and certainly no child deserves inequity in their lives. Every child deserves the same chance to succeed. We can only do that through a stable and fair educational system. Taking away spending decisions from local district means taking away local decisions about what's best for our kids. Who knows better what's best for our kids than we do? As with many changes, what may sound great on paper and marketing rarely translates to real life. Whenever change like this happens, the people who suffer most are low to moderate income families, our friends and neighbors who are already scraping bottom to create quality of life for themselves. Every time I find myself debating school taxes with someone, I come back to a poignant quote by writer John Green. You do not need to be a student to have a child who is a student to benefit from public education. Every second of every day of your life, you benefit from public education. This proposal for property tax reform has a potential to weaken the public education system in the greater Susquehanna Valley. It could hurt our children by disassembling the financial foundation upon which school resources are built without a realistic plan for rebuilding. And it could hurt working families by increasing their financial burden. It's everyone's job to be educated about policies affecting our schools in our backyard and the children next door and fight for the best future for all. Thank you.
Joanne, thank you for giving a face to many of the situations that our kids are facing. We really appreciate that. The next person I'd like to bring up is a business owner, an ex-teacher, and a school board member. And I think he has an interesting perspective we'd like to hear from. That's Mr. Brett Hosterman.
Good evening. My name is Brett Hosterman. I'm a proud resident of the Milton Area School District, and I also serve on its board of directors. I'm really proud of the work that the Milton Area School District has done over the past couple years and the achievements and successes that our students continue to experience despite the fiscal challenges that we face. Recently, we were awarded Blue Ribbon's Award for Excellence, Educational Excellence, the PA Excellence in E-Learning Model Cyber School, AP District Honor Roll, U.S. News and World Report Bronze Medalists, CTE Honor for Nocte Performance, KTO Innovation Awards. Our band and choir students continue to reach state and regional competition levels, along with our student athletes competing consistently at district and statewide competitions. We even won the Scholastic Scrimmage in the spring of 2015, just to name a few. Throughout all of the budgetary trials and tribulations, we have fiscally managed to retain our arts programs, our academic programs, most of our academic programs, our athletic programs, but it hasn't been easy. As a former educator, music educator myself within the Milton Area School District, I've experienced firsthand the struggles that school districts have been forced to deal with, including my own job being considered for elimination. Every year, the Board of Directors, along with school administration, have had to make difficult decisions about the district needs for facilities, resources, programming, staffing, and of course, raising taxes. Milton's budget process, with many other schools, starts in January, and in May, we approve our final budget. In the last 6 years, we have moved through the budget process without a state-approved budget. So everything that we've approved is done so without one major revenue source, state funding. Yet we are mandated by law to have a school district approved budget by June 30th. To date, we are again moving through a budget process without knowing of the 2017-2018 budget and a possible change in taxation structure, or without any understanding of what a change could potentially look like. How do the 500 school districts in Pennsylvania conduct business without knowing where their funding is coming from? In Milton alone, we commit approximately $40 million to educating our students, but we don't know what our state funding model will look like or how much we could get toward that budget. Mandates continue to be imposed on school districts. For example, how to report student discipline data in PA School Code Chapter 10, to highly qualified teacher course information, student demographic data, PVOS scores, Act 16 special education data, mandated reporting, child abuse clearance requirements, including Act 24, 34, 114, 126, 151, 168, PATI reporting, access, CTE, child accounting, ELL, Title IX, graduation and dropout cohort, Keystone and PSSA exam data, annual concussion and cardiac training to suicide prevention, safe schools, CATS, homeless and foster care reporting, Act 48, transportation subsidy reporting, bus evacuation drills and fire drills, Act 80, homebound reporting, PlanCon, AED reporting, SAP, AEDY reporting, restraint reporting, first aid and CPR, gifted Chapter 14, group insurance rates, Title I, Title II, Title IID, and SRO training, along with principal and teacher performance evaluation reportings, not to mention we educate our students. Budget impacts to date include decreasing in our staffing approximately 29 teachers and administrative positions, limited course offerings, and minimal facility upgrades and updates, and the inability to stay marketplace competitive in wages and benefits. So as we look to a new tax structure, a potential new tax structure, we would ask the following questions. What is the funding plan if school taxes are eliminated? If a tax change is to occur, what is the communication plan for all stakeholders? And currently, the state funding model causes inequity. How can equity in student tuition disbursement be guaranteed with a new tax plan? Thank you.
Brett, thank you very much. Next, we'd like to bring up the Chief Financial Officer for the Central Susquehanna Intermediate Unit and a past business administrator in the local school district, Mr. Charles Peterson.
Thank you and good evening. Public education faces many, many challenges, and we're here tonight mostly to talk about inequitable funding. But tied to inequitable funding, I'd like to focus my remarks tonight just on the property tax elimination. Dr. DiRocco's here tonight representing the Pennsylvania Association of School Administrators, PASA, Kathy Swope, the Pennsylvania Association of School Boards, also in the mix here is the Pennsylvania Association of School Business Officials, PASBO. All three of these organizations have done a tremendous job analyzing this current memo. I don't think it's called a bill yet. And if you go to any one of their websites, you will find some very, very valuable information. From the Pennsylvania Association of School Business Officials, there's a flyer called Implications of Property Tax Elimination, Implications of Property Tax Elimination for Parents, and Implications of Property Tax Elimination for Taxpayers, along with a lot of other information, including maps such as the one that was put up here showing that in our region, the vast majority of our school districts and communities would send more money to Harrisburg than we would bring in. It's my belief that if our citizens were educated in the implications of this bill, it would not pass. But they are not educated. The word is not getting out. And I had a conversation just this week with a businessman in Harrisburg, and he said, what do you think about this property tax elimination? And as soon as I started giving him the facts, he said, oh my goodness, I can't believe I'm not hearing more about this. I didn't understand that. So as Mrs. Swope said, her husband hates property taxes. Who doesn't? If you go into any community and say, would you like to have your property taxes eliminated? It's a no-brainer. Yeah, please eliminate my property taxes. So this has a very good chance of actually happening just because it's a good thing. It's a buzzword. It's the thing that's going to make our legislators look good. I eliminated your property taxes. So I think it's just so important for us to get the word out of what does this really mean? The facts, not our opinions. What are the facts of the matter? And I think if you take the chance to look at these documents, you'll get an idea of what the facts are. Many of our panelists have made some great points tonight, and I'd like to make a couple others and maybe reemphasize a couple that they've already made. Dr. Karalja mentioned cash flow. The business administrators, the chief financial officers, the superintendents are very cognizant of what does cash flow mean. And I want to reemphasize that. All of you know that when school tax bills go out on July 1, you get a 2% discount if you pay in the first 60 days. And a lot of people take advantage of that 2% discount. So a lot of cash flow comes into our school districts between July 1 and August 30. Then you have what's called FACE. So now if you pay, you don't get a discount, you don't get a penalty, you have 60 days to do that. And finally, after those 60 days, you get a 10% penalty. So in my experience, most people are going to pay by the end of August, and then the rest that haven't paid yet are going to pay by the end of October because they really don't want to see 10% added to their tax bill. The school districts absolutely are relying on that cash flow to pay the bills. And a year ago when we didn't have a budget, Janice, was it December before we got our first payment? This end of December, beginning of January. Not one nickel from the state. Well, I shouldn't say that. There was some limited cash flow going through. I think it was federal funds. But very, very little money came through from the state. If the school districts didn't have that real estate tax to rely on, they couldn't have made their payrolls in most cases. They couldn't have paid their accounts payable. The reality is they couldn't have opened their doors. So in my opinion, that's what we're looking at here, a real potential that if this goes through, school districts won't be opening their doors. Well, why? Well, first of all, think about the bill or memo or whatever we want calling it here that's been introduced. They're saying that this begins on July 1. Beginning July 1 of 2017, school districts will not be able to levy or collect taxes. So there's two important words there. Number one, you don't levy anything, except if you still have outstanding debt, you can levy that small amount that's left over. So you're still, in most cases, going to be facing somewhat of a school tax bill. The word collect is important because what that means is you can't collect your delinquent taxes. So you've already levied those, and so folks that chose not to pay their taxes are going to be rewarded for not doing that under this current draft of a bill. The next thing is that I would like to emphasize is debt. The bill says that beginning 12/31 of 16, already passed, school districts won't be able to issue any new debt without a referendum tied to earned income and personal income taxes. So I want to ask you, what are the odds that you can go to your community and say, we'd like to build a new school, and we're going to add a percent to your earned income tax, your personal income tax. We're going to add some money so that we can fund this. Throughout history, across the nation, school districts that have had to go to referendum for construction projects have overwhelmingly failed. And now we're faced with a situation where one of the most valuable assets our communities have are our school systems. It's one of the first things people look at when they are going to move into a community. And even if you're going to a job, you say, okay, here's where my job is. Now, where's the best school for my kids? What's going to happen if our schools continue to deteriorate and we can't invest the money to fix them up? And, you know, you've heard the stories about technology and science and all of the different new ways that we're teaching kids now. Well, our schools still haven't caught up. They haven't been able to fix up their schools in many cases to have the resources, the technology, the classroom environments to give a good education to kids. And now we're completely shutting that off. Mrs. Swope talked about the business taxes in her district. I thought that was great because she brought it down to a personal level and gave an example of her school district. But I want to take that to a state macro level. The estimate is a $2.7 billion tax shift. So the businesses are going to pay $2.7 billion. They're not going to pay $2.7 billion. It's going to be shifted to the citizens. So as soon as we talk about elimination, it's important to keep saying it's a tax shift, I think, as Dr. Duraco said. And so then I hear buzzwords like, well, this is really going to help the poor, and it's going to help our senior citizens on fixed income. And I ask, well, let's start with the poor. How is it going to help the poor? Let's state two scenarios. One is I rent. I can't afford to buy a house, so I rent. And now I have to pay an extra percent in sales taxes, almost 2%, 1.88%, almost 1.9% in sales taxes. And you say, I'm sorry, the sales is 7%. So it's going from 6 to 7. And some people would say, well, it's only 1%. What's the problem? Well, you didn't have to pay anything on clothes. You didn't have to pay anything on food. You didn't have to pay anything for most services. Now, even when you go to a mortician, that's a service, you're going to have to pay not an extra percent, 7 new percent on those items. So the poor that rented are not going to get a reduction in property taxes because they didn't have any. And now when they go to the store, they have to pay additional sales taxes. And if they have a job, they have to pay additional earned income taxes. On senior citizens, some would benefit. Again, this is a tax shift. Some people will benefit, some won't. But this isn't just earned income. It's personal income. And I think we have to remember that. Next issue is tax collection. We have an archaic system. We've been talking about that for a long, long time. Our tax collection system is very archaic. I think this would even get worse now because the law is still there of how you have to have elect tax collectors and use tax collectors. But now your school districts would still be sending out much smaller tax bills, but the envelope still goes out, the stamp still goes out, and paying the tax collector would still be a fact. So in the grand scheme of the priority here, that's a smaller one, but it's still an important consideration. The next point is that what right now when we deduct our personal income tax, our real estate taxes, when we do our federal tax returns, and you would no longer be doing that. And the estimate is that it would be a windfall to the feds of $600 million. So that's $600 million coming out of our pockets and going to Washington. So our local taxes won't stay local any longer. I think it's interesting when you look at that map and you see Southeast Pennsylvania and Philadelphia and Pittsburgh, and you see those sections where, well, now more money is going to come into their communities that go out. When I talk to the business administrators and school personnel in those areas, they're against this too because of the loss of local control, the inability to borrow to build schools any longer, and the fact that their businesses will no longer, a lot of that money in those parts of the state that are paying $28,000 per kid in real estate taxes, a lot of that is coming from the businesses. So that all has to shift to the local taxpayers now. So in closing, many of our panelists talked about the cuts that have already happened for the last several years. Under this new bill, if it would go through, additional cuts are absolutely imminent, and so you're now cutting where you've been cutting for years, and there's really not any place left to cut. So thank you very much.
Chuck, thank you very much for your insights. The level of detail you provided was very valuable. Our last perspective is going to come from Ms. Janice Venna, who is a school business administrator and also in multiple districts and has a great deal of experience she can share with us. So please.
Thank you and good evening. I think pretty much everything's been said about the Senate Bill 76 and about the status of school districts over the past, I can go 25 years, but just say the past 10 years. I'm going to start with Senate Bill 76, and when I was reading the draft of it, it's not really what's out there proposed yet, but they're raising the PIT and the sales tax, the concern that I saw right away is that the real estate tax would go away July 1st. And if you know how taxes are collected, the sales tax and the personal income tax, they don't come in a lump sum July 1st. They come over the course of the year in quarterly payments for businesses. So that means there'd be a lag there. I don't know how the state is going to come up with that money July 1st to fund the schools, because our bills go on. We're supporting different businesses in the area. We have salaries and benefits that are contractual. We just can't not pay them. And as Chuck had mentioned, schools could close due to that fact. The other thing that is very disturbing, the district's debt service is about 16.68%. We're still going to send tax bills out for that, which means, as Chuck had mentioned, we're still going to pay a tax collector and send out envelopes and the stamps and the postage, et cetera. And people, I don't think they all have the message that this is not property tax elimination. And that is one example. That 16.68% for Danville area is $2.2 million. So bills will still be going out. There's still county and municipal taxes as well. And in speaking about the commercial properties, in Danville, it's 21.28% of the properties are commercial. And once again, those businesses will no longer have real estate taxes, and families and individuals in our district will be paying for that 21.28% of real estate taxes. The other item, I know everybody's touched on this already, but you're prohibited in this bill from assessing, levying, or collecting property taxes after 6/30/2017. For the district, we usually have about 5% delinquency every year on real estate taxes. It comes to about $700,000. That money would be gone away, $700,000 to the Danville Area School District. The way the system is now, we get most of that money back in the subsequent year, about $600,000. That's a big concern. I'm trying to make this all work from my desk. And as has been repeated before, about going to a voter referendum if you want to have new debt or to raise an earned income tax or PIT, it would need voter approval. Think about how difficult it is to develop and balance a budget with soaring retirement costs, health insurance, unfunded mandates, and very little state funding increases. We also have, at this point, the Act 1 limitation. That's going to go away, but it really has our hands tied behind our back as far as how much money we can generate on our own. We are dependent on real estate taxes. We are dependent on state funding. Danville's down to about 39% from the state. At one time, most districts got 50% funding from the state. Danville has done a lot of work, the school board, the administration, and the superintendent over the past 6 years. Staff has been reduced. About 35 individuals have lost their jobs through attrition, or because we had too many paraprofessionals and teachers, we were bare bones. Danville's been very fortunate. We've been able to hold on steadily, but not all districts can. A lot of districts are borrowing money that they can't afford to borrow. I guess I should touch a little bit, as Mrs. Swope did, about the retirement. I went back 6 years. It was 8.65% in 2011-12. 6 years later, counting the 2017-18 year, at 32.57%. That is a 376% increase in retirement, what we pay out for retirement. That impacts our budget greatly. And the other concern that I have, it's one thing Senate Bill 76 that I'm worried about how the state's going to fund that for us July 1st, but they're not going to have a budget in place from the way it seems to me. And as I said, I mentioned it was like December, January until we received any money. How do you think a school operates without any monies coming in from the state? I mean, I just don't pull it out of my pocket. You know what I mean? It's not there. And we have people that are worried about not getting paid and paying their bills and paying the vendors that all the districts support with buying, purchasing books and technology. It's very difficult this time, and I know everybody's said all the points that were so eloquently said, but Danville area, we've worked very hard to try and keep things bare bones, and I don't see how we can do both, coupled with a stalemate with the budget, and if they take away property tax, I don't see how we can pay our bills and have our school doors open. Thank you.
As she's doing that, I just wanted to, before we turn it over for questions, I moved to this area in 1997 to raise my kids here, and I'm proud to say they've all graduated from wonderful schools. The Susquehanna Valley is an amazing place in terms of the education that's provided to our students, and I've seen that in multiple districts, and I've also seen it because of the professionals that represent them. The idea that these folks were able to take the time out to come and present and share their thoughts about this is because of how much they believe in the power of education in our area. At this time, we wanted to turn it over to see if people had any questions. In most cases, superintendents are dealing with questions from parents that have a very unique perspective for their particular child. It's actually refreshing to talk about an issue on a larger scale like this. So we're anxious to hear if you have any questions. I'm sure the panel will be glad to answer them for you as best we can.